want dat spoof weghalen. Het is hemelvaart, ja. En ik ben van een oude communist atheist family. So my idea of hemelvaart is niet zo secular. Maar we hebben een prachtig concert bij Joe Ryan over een idee tussen hem en Jerry Hunt. De hekste Amerikaanse componist dat has died. So he is een soort, he died. Quite tragically. And he is een soort communication with him, yeah? Now the concert van Joel, they have een kort pauze for oxygen, yeah? And not a pauze in lezing over the history of spiritual reformation. And this is to prepare you for the ungodly sights you will see in Bentveld. It's so nice to have it so unpleasantly crowded. Yeah? Nice for me, bad for you. I will tell you two things. Er zijn een video monitor en ook grote doosjes in de bar. En als het is grote doosjes voor geluid. Ja? My idea is to never learn the words and the tools of my trade in human language. So you can flee, yeah, and watch it in Italian style, al fresco. Yeah? That's number one. Yeah. Number two, if anyone shouts fire, I'll kill them. And number three is we have only one large bus going to Bentveld, and we have too many people to fit in it, as you know, if you call to make reservations for it. You might have been told there are no seats left. So. My original concept of this project was the invasion of Normandy. But now it's more like the evacuation of Dunkirk. Now, what this means is all of you with small boats, autootjes. Als je hebt stoelen vrij, wil je praten met je boerman of boervrouw? Heb je een ride nodig? Heb je een rijden nodig? Ja, zeker. Of nee. En misschien het is de start van een hele mooie relatie. Ja? Omdat op een avond als die tussen Amsterdam en Bentveld, ja, anything could happen. So, dat is het. Joel Ryan and company. En dank u wel al voor het komen.
Tonight is Memory, Action, and Mandolin, which is a line from Jerry Hunt's extensive correspondence with myself and his father. And Jerry was very interested in the relationship between the, let's say, the spirit world and the normal world. So he became obsessed with John Dee, a famous geometer and mathematician and astrologer at the court of Queen Elizabeth, who was unfortunately expelled, like many men were, from the court of Queen Elizabeth. Ended up in Prague and was defenestrated, as is apparently the tradition in Prague for getting rid of undesirable people. And that's what they say, apparently, from experience in the circles. Jerry was especially interested in Wiggelsdis, as they say in Netherlands, but in dowsing. And the collaboration we're going to do is about dowsing. So there's going to be an aspect of tonight's performance about the process of dowsing or looking for things with mechanical amplifiers or physical amplifiers of inner states. And that's about all I want to say. But,
Thank you. Thank you.
17.000 met de muziek by Louis Wahl Gottschalk in the background. Sorry for my slightly errors and my slightly angles. It kept an order on him by the Kunstner, so that is that my idee over Dunkirk is too vague. Yeah? We must have organisatie here. The organisatie is in days of form. If you have a car, if you are driving to Bentveld, if you have three seats, put up your arm.
Yes.
Yeah. So everyone go make friends with someone. They work. Anyone with three seats? Yeah. Yeah. Mensen met stoelen vrij. Okay. So make friends. Yeah. Are you ready? Yeah. All right. Later, we'll pioneer the spiritual reformation. At Elise Corain, text by Susan Tolman.
Door closed.
Can you close the door, please?
Rational perspective of our digital age, it is difficult to understand the profound connection that existed in the 19th century between developments in the sciences of electricity and what is now regarded as the pseudoscience of spiritualism. In the ebb tide between the discoveries of Mesmer in the 18th century and those of Freud at the end of the 19th, a wave of uncanny phenomena swept through the powers of America, England, and the continent. The earliest of these phenomena were Morse code-like raps that occurred without apparent physical cause. These were followed by ringing bells, musical instruments that played untouched by human hands, and furniture that moved of its own accord. Later came appearances of lights, of quasi-human voices, then the materialization of human hands and faces, and the apparent passage of solids through solids without disintegration. A second class of phenomena consisted in writing and drawing through the medium's hand, convulsive movements, involuntary dancing, entrancement, and personation by the medium of the deceased. Well-bred ladies passed into trances where they spoke the patois of sailors, and vice versa. The popular explanation for these phenomena, that the spirits of the dead continue to hover above us and can be communicated with at will, may seem far-fetched. But remember that this was an era within which the far-fetched regularly became the near-fetched. Imagine the first demonstrations of man-made lightning, telegraphy, radio, or gramophones. Some early users of the telephone thought it was a form of mental telepathy. If we were participating in the domicorsi, my medicine would bring what you're on slash like magnetism before it, provided proof positive of invisible forces capable of acting over distances. The first radio users thought listening to the radio was like being at a seance. The mediums of spiritualism anticipated the technological medium. Both produced voices and messages from thin air, but nowhere. The ether was giving up its secrets, but not its aura of secret. Mesmer had theorized a universe filled with a quantifiable, if invisible, magnetic force. Da war es besser sein mit Overheitsfastmilitären, da war die Facilität für Erdgrüne Fonds. If invisible, magnetic fluids and forces. Later scientists proposed a luminiferous ether through which mysterious and invisible forces travelled. As with atomic physics a generation later, electrical discoveries seemed to point beyond the known physical world into one of essences, from intuitive mechanical causality into something demonstrable but nonetheless unknowable. Whether the finger on the telegraph or the voice on the telephone resided in this world or in another one. The great English physicist, Sir Adi Prophet, want to say the South Africa, pure underground, or whose own work anticipated that of Marconi, regarding the existence of the luminiferous ether itself as a justification not only for a belief in the paranormal, or what he called mental radio, but also for a belief in the survival of the soul after death. Lodge was not alone in being both an eminent scientist and an ardent spiritualist. The Societies for Psychical Research counted among their members Sir William Crookes, the great American philosopher William Reach, and Sigmund Freud. Other prominent believers included John Roebling, the engineer of the Brooklyn Bridge, and one of the most distinguished intellects in 19th century America. He has been trained as an engineer in Germany. Philosophically, he began as an Emersonian Hegelian, and with a strenuous faith in the individual's power to master himself and the world. And he ended by what seemed to him a logical progression as an enthusiastic spiritualist. Roebling believed that man's ability to master his environment, to build bridges and roads where nature had left none, a form of stubborn recalcitrance destined to be overcome by mind or spirit. A technological achievement like the Brooklyn Bridge provided an exact parallel to a successful seance. Both the engineer and the medium forced the material world to yield up its spiritual desire. Between the earth and man arose the leaf. Between the heaven and man came the cloud, his life being partly as the falling leaf and partly as the flying vapor, at least temporarily. An antidote to the crisis of religious faith brought on by the scientific and industrial revolutions. So long as religion was paramount, John Bellamy has written in his similarly his story of proving what most people took for granted, that we are more than just complex automata. Spiritualism offered hope of a universe that might not, after all, be the soulless machine which the new scientific materialism was propagating. A secret inclination towards the miraculous, as has been claimed, that he never relinquished his faith in the miraculous, and that all his so-called science was an attempt to give this faith the status of objective truth. This question of the powers of the mind or spirit in a mechanistic cosmos was critical not only to spiritualism. The mid-19th century was the era of the mind cure, mind over matter philosophies that could be found in equal measure in the settling fictions of Pollyanna, the religious imperatives of Mary Baker Eddy's Christian Science. Despite the stark contrast between Freud's bleak cosmology, in which optimism exists only as precursor to disillusion, and that of Eddy and spiritualism, both of which asserted the essential and profound goodness of the universe, uniformly, the spirit spoke of hope and love, wrapping up cheerful postcards from the place they called Summerland, a brighter world, the homeward way. The Victorian era was, of course, the great age of the ghost story, of Scrooge and Marley, the monkey's paw, the phantom coach. Narratives of the uncanny. The uncanny, as detailed by Freud in his essay on the subject, indexes virtually all the phenomena associated with seances. Confusion. Animate and inanimate objects. An assurance of immortality. It becomes the uncanny harbinger of death. Reasserting this unbounded self-love in the guise of unbounded universalistic love. Here was neither hellfire nor brimstone, nor pits of snakes, but a rational, graded system of escalation towards purity as the spirit moved through various levels towards God. The communicants were inevitably either the recently dead, or those who were having problems graduating to a higher level. Spirits of a very ethereal nature cannot affect material substances, and so must influence the earthbound spirits. Amen. Innistat. Niederwehr. Wege interessiert. That kommt, that kann nicht bleiben. Ich werd gek. This was a convenient explanation for the mischievous nature of communicating spirits, who tended to be of a singularly low order, frequently lying, or throwing things, or on one occasion dousing the paint of Dante Gabriel Rossetti with a spray of... over more useful communications about the structure of the cosmos. It is true. Our unconscious has as little use as it ever had for the idea of its own mortality. We have reached a point where it is not only specific objects of belief that have become discredited, but the very capacity to believe. Are we not spirits? That are shaped into a body, into an appearance, that fade away into air invisibility. This is no metaphor. It is a simple scientific fact. We start out of nothing, take figure and our apparitions, round us and on the very spectre is eternity. And to eternity, minutes are as years and eons. We have but faith. We cannot know. For knowledge is of things we see. All the old promises. It is me, the whole distress I. Sublimest sense of eternity achieved. Mystic speculation. Clouds and glories and darkness. Between the earth and man arose the leaf. Between heaven and man came the cloud. His life being partly as the falling leaf.
Being partly as a falling leaf and partly as a flying vapor.
Thank you. very nice.
Thank you.
Thank you. Yeah. Thank you. Yes, and